Hello everyone. So in today's video, we will be learning about one of the transmembrane signaling mechanisms, and that is G protein coupled receptors. In these receptors, there is a presence of extracellular domain on these receptors which contain ligand binding area, which means when there will be presence of a ligand, it will come to this area and bind for the activation of this receptor. But the intracellular domain interacts with G proteins or effector molecules. So this is the intracellular domain of these receptors. So there are many kinds of G protein receptors. We will be discussing about them later. So in the cell membrane, there is presence of G proteins, which are actually composed of three subunits. So these three subunits are actually alpha, beta and gamma. So if we draw over here, if this is the gamma unit, this is the beta unit, and this is the alpha unit. And along with alpha unit, there is presence of a molecule called as GDP. So this molecule is GDP, and GDP stands for guanosine diphosphate, which means it has two phosphate. G protein is also present in the lipid bilayer structure. So what happens when there is a ligand present over here? What will happen? That this ligand will bind to the binding area of the extracellular domain of this receptor, and this binding will lead to the activation of this receptor. And when there is activation of this receptor, what actually happens? Now the binding of receptor causes the conformational changes in these G protein. This GDP is replaced by GTP, which is guanosine triphosphate. That it means that it has three phosphate units. So what will happen? That GDP will be dissociated while the GTP will associate to the alpha subunit of G protein. In this way, this will cause the activation of G protein. So what happened? First of all, ligand activated the receptor, and receptor activated the G protein. And now when the G protein is activated, what will happen? The G protein, which were being coupled with receptors, are now being dissociated from the receptors and will move toward cellular effector to show their response. And this is gamma, and this is beta subunit, and this is now alpha subunit, which has molecule called as GTP being attached to it. After the attachment of GTP molecule, what will happen? That there will be formation of two complexes. One complex gamma and beta, and the second one is alpha along with its GTP. This complex, and the second one is this complex. So now there will be interaction between these complexes with effector, cellular effectors. So what will happen? That the interaction between cellular effectors and these complexes will cause the further action inside the cell. When there will be an interaction between these complexes and effectors, what will happen? That there will be production of second messenger molecules. these messenger molecules may further cause the activation of other effectors present in the cell, and this will produce a signal cascade effect, which means there will be further increase in the cellular response, and there will be transmission of signal from outside of the cell to inside of the cell through this mechanism. If we talk about the individual subunits functioning, so alpha subunit is responsible for the attachment or binding of GTP, whereas gamma and beta are responsible for the anchoring of G protein in the cell membrane. There are many types of G protein, but main of them are GS, GI, GQ. And now the effector of GS and GI is same, whereas there is separate effector for GQ. So now let's talk about GS and GI, which have a common effector. So what happened in these? This complex interacts with an enzyme which is called as adenylyl cyclase. This all mechanism is going on in cell membrane. After the dissociation of these two complexes, what happens? That this complex having alpha and GTP in it will bind or interact with adenyl cyclase. So when this will interact with adenyl cyclase, what will happen? There's, as its name indicates, it is an enzyme. It will cause the conversion of ATP into CAMP. Along with it, inorganic pyrophosphate. Now CAMP stands for cyclic adenosine monophosphate, and PPi stands for inorganic pyrophosphate. So now ATP is converted into these two substances. So this is caused by the activation of this enzyme, and this activation is caused by interaction between these two. But G copper protein receptor having GQ, phospholipase C. Now it is also an enzyme, and it generates two messenger molecules, which are inositol 1,4,5 triphosphate, which is also known as IP3. Along with it, there is also production of diacylglycerol, which is also called as DAG. These two examples, adenyl cyclase and phospholipase C, are cellular effectors, whereas CAMP or IP3 and DAG, all three of them are actually second messenger molecules, which are being produced by the interaction of complex and effector molecule. Whereas messenger molecules can be CAMP, IP3 or DAG. As I said before, these second molecules can further cause the activation of effectors present inside the cell. CAMP and DAG can cause activation of protein kinases. As its name indicates, that it also has A's in it, which means that This is also an enzyme. So these two cause the activation of protein kinases, which cause the effect called as signaling cascade. Whereas IP3 regulates intracellular free calcium concentration as well as some of these protein kinases. So now we can say that these further effectors can be protein kinases in this case. In this case, we have discussed about effectors which are enzymes, but it is not always the case. In other cases, there can be effectors which are protein in nature, or they can be ion channels which act as cellular effectors. When there is presence of a ligand, there is replacement of GDP with GTP. Whereas when this ligand is removed, what will happen? That this GTP will remove its one of the phosphate molecule. In this way, what will happen? In this way, there will be again formation of GDP, which is guanosine diphosphate, because one of the phosphate is now removed. So what will happen? This will go back to its original position, and like it will bind again to its gamma and beta subunit, and then these three things along with GDP will bind back to the receptor molecule where it was being attached before. So it was the ligand which make them replace GDP with GTP, and it caused the dissociation of these two complexes. In the presence of no ligand, what happened? That this G protein is actually binded to this receptor, and which is when activated, it caused the dissociation of G protein and caused intracellular responses. So now this ligand can be either drug or it can be endogenous agonist, which is actually naturally present inside the body or being produced inside the body. So as we have talked about these three types of G proteins, so GQ is responsible for stimulation or for activation of phospholipase C, activates or stimulate. But GS actually stimulates adenyl cyclase, whereas GI actually inhibits adenyl cyclase. So these are actually working opposite to each other on the same effector. It is very important to understand how these G protein coupled receptor work, because when you are studying further mechanism of drugs, the basic concept of these receptors should be cleared. So again, let's revise what are G protein receptor. Ligand bind to the extracellular domain of this receptor, which is over here. So this binding causes the activation of this receptor. When there is activation of the receptor, what happened? That this GDP, which was being binded to the alpha subunit of the G protein, is replaced by the GTP. And this replacement caused the activation of G protein. This activation further lead to dissociation of the subunits into two complexes. And one of the complex contain beta and gamma subunit, whereas the other contain alpha and GTP. So what happened? That these two complexes can further interact with cellular effectors that can be either an enzyme, a protein, or an ion channel that are responsible for further action within cell. These responses usually last several seconds to minutes, and sometimes these activated effectors further produce second messenger molecules, and these second messenger molecules can further activate or further interact with other effectors, and in this way there is a signal cascade effect. So if you talk about some of the examples of G protein, which are GS, GI and GQ. So in GS and GI, there is a common effector which is called as adenyl cyclase, and as its name indicates, it is an enzyme. So what happens when there is activation of this enzyme by the attachment of this complex with it, with this enzyme, what happens that there is conversion of ATP into cyclic AMP along with the inorganic pyrophosphate. Whereas in GQ, there is activation of phospholipase C, which causes the production of second messenger molecules, which are inositol 1,4,5-triphosphate, that is also known as IP3, and diacylglycerol, which is also known as DAG. So now CAMP and DAG and IP3, these all are actually second messenger molecule, whereas effectors in these cases were adenyl cyclase and phospholipase C. If we talk about further effectors which are present in this example, which are protein kinases, as its name indicates, it is again an enzyme. So it is not always the case, they can be either protein or ion channel, but here in this case they are enzyme. So the activation of protein kinase cause the further reactions within the cell. So whereas IP3 is also responsible for regulating intracellular free calcium concentration. So this was all about G copper protein receptors. If you have any questions, let me know in the comment section below, and thank you for watching my videos.